Ferrier. I am an official artist for Kerouac Saxophones and Buffet Crampon, and I wanted to do a quick video to talk to you about my new instrument, the Senzo saxophone, and talk about the features of this saxophone and compare it with my Kerouac saxophone. First of all, the general manufacturing of this instrument is of the highest quality. When I take a saxophone, I just by feeling the instrument, I can feel the quality of the instrument, the quality of the metal. Like a cheap instrument is going to have a metal that is too soft very often. It's better to have a metal that is too hard, you know, even if the repairman complains about it, rather than an instrument that has keys that bend too easily. Also, I check out the quality of the cork. You want the cork on the neck and, you know, like the cork on the keys to be hard enough but not too hard. Also, you want to make sure that they are cut precisely. Same thing with the felt and obviously the pads. You want the pads to have a high quality lever. On the Senzo, it has metal resonators. So I've been playing this instrument for about 6 months now, and I've been traveling also a lot. I fly at least once a month, and instruments don't like to fly. They don't like to travel. With the saxophones, it often results in the keys shifting a little bit and consequently making a lot of noise. I've been playing and traveling with this instrument for 6 months, and check it out. So I'm actually quite impressed, not quite impressed, I'm very impressed by how well it's been holding. All right. You can do the test with your instrument, see, you know, how much noise does it make compared to mine. Also, everything is holding very nicely, you know, like here it doesn't move. Sometimes you might notice on your instrument, if it's moving, if those parts are moving at all, you need to go to the repairman so that it gets it adjusted. You don't want these parts to be moving. Also, often I've noticed on some saxophones, on the side keys, you might have some play. You know, when you press the key, sometimes there's some room before it actually opened the related key. You don't want that, as little as possible. Sometimes it's necessary, but you want to avoid that as much as possible. And on this instrument, there's never any play between those keys, so that's also a sign of a good instrument. I choose the silver-plated instrument, and they have it in gold-plated and red copper, I believe. And again, I can see, I can feel that, you know, the silver is very nice, and it's gonna hold for a long time. And the engraving is very nice. Also, it's actually beautiful. It's handmade. I think they do the hand engraving in France. This is a very nice instrument. It's in tune, and it's even throughout the entire register. Register that stands out or that sounds dual compared to another register, so that's very nice. Now, some characteristic features of this instrument. First of all, it's a small bell, actually the regular size bell compared to the Kenworth, for instance. They have a large bell. They have a very nice pinky table, and actually I think that's a characteristic of the Buffet Crampon saxophones. And I know the S1 had the same type of table. It's small, condensed, and like the vintage saxophones. Today, the modern saxophones, they have a much bigger pinky table. As you can see on the Kenilworth, the table is much bigger, and the bell also. On this one, it's smaller, more condensed, and also the B flat key is split up in two, so that also makes the navigation through each key much easier. So that's also kind of cool. Now, Buffet Crampon owns Kenilworth. Buffet Crampon is a French company, and Kenilworth is a German company. The Kenilworth factory is in Germany, and the Buffet Crampon in France. They took from the Kenilworth saxophones, they took the pound keys, the left hand pound keys. They have a great system that is adjustable. You can adjust the height of the keys and also the directions so that it feels nice, it fits nicely your hand. All right, so that's a very, very cool feature actually. It has straight tone holes. My Kenilworth has rolled tone holes. And also you can see that the pearls are actually slightly, I don't know if you can see if it's really visible on the camera, but you know, it's not straight on the key. It's slightly tilted like this, so that, you know, it feels more comfortable for the fingers. So you might notice something funny with the neck, but don't worry, it's not a problem, it's not broken. First of all, it's cut like this because the tube is actually a little smaller, so the F sharp key, the F sharp tone hole is here, and the neck goes there. So if it was not cut out, then that would be a problem. It's large enough so that you can adjust the neck in the position that you prefer. And one more thing about the neck, it has a what they call a resonance chamber. Again, I hope you can see, you know, you can see like the shape here. That's a resonance, that's what they call the resonance chamber. They have two necks. They have the regular one, which has a resonance chamber, but it's smaller. And I think this neck is called the amplitude neck, I believe. And the resonance chamber is actually much bigger. What I found it does is it gives me a fatter sound. I have more bottom to the sound. Now, it is a little more difficult to control the intonation, so you have to be careful with that. However, with this, it's more focused. All right, so depends, you know, what you want and the balance you find with your setup with the mouthpiece and reed, obviously. So I'm going to try both necks, and I don't have the fanciest microphone, so I don't know how convincing that will be, but here it is with the amplitude neck. Regular neck. this neck to have a, how can I say, a clearer sound, you know, it's more like a crystal, you know, it makes me think of a crystal, crystalline, I don't know how you say that, but you know, sounds like crystal. And this one is a little darker, a little warmer, and you know, again, a little more bottom to the sound. To finish, I would like to compare quickly with the Kenilworth saxophone. So, to start with, I have a fairly bright sound, and with the Kenilworth saxophone, I'm really on the brighter side of the spectrum. With the Senzo, it brings me back to a darker side of the spectrum, so which is really nice. It's actually what I was trying to do this year. I wanted to have a little darker sound, so I was experimenting with like stronger reeds, new mouthpiece, etc. And then I tried the Senzo, and I really liked the sound. It was quite shocking because the keywork is very, very different from the Kenilworth. So when I tried it first, I was like, wow, this is going to be hard. But I really liked the sound, so I wanted to give it a fair try. And you know, practice for a few weeks, getting used to it, getting to know the instrument, and now it's my main instrument. So in general, I found that I get a darker sound and more focus. Also, kind of a round and focus sound compared to the Kenilworth, where I have this huge spread out sound. Alright, so much more kind of modern, contemporary type of sound. So let me quickly compare both. The tube is longer, and therefore I believe that's why it's thinner, because you have to respect a certain volume for the saxophone. And maybe that's why I have a brighter sound with the Kenilworth. It cuts through, and also with a large bell, very spread out. Instrument at least this year, because I found it to give me a darker tone, you know, and that's really what it's about. I want to have a different color. All right, that's it for now. I hope I managed to be somehow helpful, and I'll talk to you soon.